modern sport, winning is what it's all about. But how do you win? This man has learned the hard way. Now, he's ready to show you.
There was a time when the world seemed headed for destruction by hordes of warriors known to history as the Barbarians. It appeared that only the Roman army stood between survival and the end of civilization. But what was the truth? Who were the Barbarians? And how could they defeat the might of Rome? The weapons of the Barbarians, next on Conquest.
All right, guys, gather around. You are a bunch of barbarians, and you have a problem. Over many centuries, thousands of you have migrated into Europe. You now live in many tribes on the borders of a vicious, aggressive military dictatorship called the Roman Empire. Now, we are going to teach you to use a whole range of barbarian weapons, and for your final challenge, you will attack and defeat a Roman legion.
So who were the barbarians? The word may come from the Sanskrit for stammering. The Romans believed that their enemies were savage and could barely communicate. They were not Roman, therefore not civilized. This was untrue. Many of the barbarian tribes had advanced cultures and a highly developed morality, which they considered superior to the violent and decadent ways of Rome. Barbarians repeatedly defeated Roman armies in battle, but always seemed to lose the wars.
Let's look at a map. Among the first barbarian peoples who made contact with the Romans were the Gauls. And that was the Roman name for the great Celtic civilization. Extremely artistic, very warlike. Mark, you're going to be our Gaul. Now, the Romans were terrified of you, with good reason, because in 400 BC you invaded Italy and sacked Rome. Now, the Gauls were known as swordsmen, using the long sword like this one. Now, you need strength and flexibility to use that weapon, which is why most of them didn't have armour. So you will go into battle wearing exactly what they did, tattoos and otherwise completely naked.
Are you kidding?
Well, all right, sometimes they wore pants and tunics of wool and fur and hide, and like all barbarian peoples, they used spears and shields and short throwing spears called javelins.
After many wars with the Gallic tribes, Julius Caesar conquered Gaul and crushed the final resistance in 52 BC. The Romans at last took revenge for the earlier sack of Rome in 400 BC. They slaughtered the Gallic people and destroyed their civilization. But it had taken them 350 years to do it. Elsewhere, other barbarians were giving them just as hard a time.
Now, in 218 BC, the Romans invaded Hispania, Spain, where they fought for 200 years with the Celtiberians. Mario, that's you. Now, your guys were brilliant guerrilla fighters, and they had some remarkable weapons, including this one, the falcata, which is based on the ancient Greek coppice, probably brought to Spain by Greek merchants. Now, this was made of the finest quality steel, and the design put the weight of the blade down towards the end, increasing what's called the kinetic efficiency of the blow. In other words, get out of the way. Now, the Celtiberians had another sword called a gladius. You might recognize this. It's a simple, short, stabbing sword. And they had a spear made entirely of iron called a soliferum. Now, these guys were great metalworkers. It's possible that they even invented nail. So, Mario, you've got nail.
Many Spanish and Celtic weapons were copied by the Romans. The short sword became the basis for the Roman gladius. The soliferum may have been the antecedent of the Roman javelin called the pilum. The Romans knew a good weapon when they saw one, and they needed them. In 115 BC, what we think was an early Germanic tribe called the Cimbri invaded Italy. They defeated five Roman armies, one after another. This led the Roman general Marius to completely reorganize the Roman army. The Cimbri were defeated in 102 BC, but the Germanic invasions had only just begun.
The Germanic tribes also used the spear and shield, but they had a bunch of their own weapons as well, including this one, the sax, a short chopping and stabbing weapon. Here, shove that in your belt. They also used the axe. This is the largest type, the broad axe. Now, this could really carve into a Roman shield, but you need both hands to use it. The smallest version was this, the Francisca, or the throwing axe. But you just try throwing one of these.
So that's what our team is going to do. Toss a variety of axes against these Roman shields. The throwing axe was useless against a shield. But it wasn't used like that. It was thrown high into the air in large numbers. It must have been very discouraging to get hit with one of these.
I also want to show you this. It's a falx, a double-handed weapon popular with another group of barbarians called the Dacians. Chris, you're a Dacian? Now, the Dacians lived in an area of Europe that is now Romania. And from 81 AD, the Romans attacked them. You know, these Romans, they are not nice people to be neighbours with. So now we've got four basic types of barbarian. We have the Gaul, the Celt, the German, and the Dacian. They're remarkable warriors and all had excellent and different types of weapons.
The barbarians came from different regions and brought different weapons into battle, but they shared the same tactics, or rather, tactic. There was only one.
The direct frontal charge. There are the Romans. Get ready for them.
After building themselves up into a frenzy, the barbarians would make a mass charge directly at the Roman line. The idea was to run in as fast as possible so that the Roman javelins would have less effect. Sometimes, on a signal, they would withdraw and then charge again, repeatedly. They wanted the Romans to use up all their javelins and be forced back, or to get the Romans to break ranks and give chase. Then they could be cut down individually. These charges must have looked magnificent and terrifying. Unfortunately, they hardly ever worked.
Simple. I mean, they would have killed us with javelins before we ever got there.
The Romans were professional soldiers. The barbarians just weren't.
The charge feels great. But do we stand a chance when we get there?
I mean, these were just hay bales. The real Romans, we never would have broke their lines. We would have got chopped to pieces.
He's right. The Romans always kept a reserve of fresh soldiers to replace the front line, and plenty of spare javelins. They didn't tire easily, and they were too disciplined to break ranks. These were the finest soldiers the Empire had to offer.
The classic Roman legionary from about 100 AD. So what do you notice about him? The absolute basics.
He's a foot soldier.
He's well protected.
He is the best heavy infantryman in the world. But like all heavy infantry, he has two weaknesses. Cavalry and missile weapons. So from the earliest times, the Romans protected this man by raising mercenary cavalry and infantry from you guys, their enemies. They would divide you up, make friends with some of you, attack the others. They used Gallic and German cavalry, archers from Syria, slingers from the Balearic Islands. They would divide you up, make friends with some of you, attack the others. They used Gallic and German cavalry, archers from Syria, slingers from the Balearic Islands, and infantry with javelins, swords, spears, and shields from Germany, Gaul, and Dacia. So, we know that this guy has some weaknesses. Now let's work out how to defeat this creep.
Our team has met the enemy. Now they must learn how to beat him. Our team has studied early barbarian tactics. Now they need more practice with barbarian weapons before meeting a Roman legion in battle.
This is the spear, the absolutely basic weapon of all ancient peoples. It's simply a pole with a pointed blade on the end. Now, the spear could be used by individual warriors or by massed infantry. The infantry spearman would usually carry a shield in the left hand. He would carry his spear either in the high guard or the low guard. Would you line up behind me and beside me? Now, combined with other spearmen, he could either defend himself or advance behind a wall of spears and shields. Spears, Now, this could be very effective, especially against cavalry and infantry.
Ready? By the left, advance!
But the individual spearmen had very little manoeuvrability, and the whole system requires a great deal of discipline, training, and cohesion.
Ready? Charge!
Even then, the Romans found this to be no difficulty at all. They would just fix the spears with their shields and chop their way through them. So most barbarians fought as individuals.
The individual warrior used a fighting spear of about 7 to 8 feet long. Any longer than that, and it would become unmanageable. Now, to use it effectively, you have to have both hands, so no shield, which means you have to rely on the spear both for offense and defense. Now, you could use body armor and a helmet, but these are heavy and slow you down, so most barbarians didn't use them. That's better. Now, against other spears, you have to clear your opponent's blade before you can thrust in yourself. And there are lots of fancy parries and avoidances, all of which are completely useless if you can't counterattack immediately. Right, let's try it against our Roman. Now, the spear is a stabbing weapon. The idea is to keep it moving, keep it thrusting in repeatedly, changing direction with both the blade and the body. This keeps your opponent guessing. He never knows what's going to hit him next. And it also prevents him from having a chance to cut down at your blade. Don't let him do that. Because your spear then becomes a stick, and you look very stupid indeed. Now, the one great advantage you have with the Roman is distance. You keep stabbing in, trying to find his weak points. Go high, force him to lift up that heavy shield. Go for the legs and then high. Keep him guessing. Go for the shield side with a feint and then stab into the unprotected body. Feint, stab! Of course, if he's any good, and believe me, he is good, he's not going to stand there while you do this. He's going to try and get inside and attack, because once he is inside this spear, you're a dead man.
The team try out spear techniques against each other, then against sword and shield. The problem with the spear is that in battle, you don't have the space to dodge about. You have warriors beside you and behind you. You may have two stabs with it before a Roman is on top of you. Shorter and lighter spears were less effective in close combat, but could be used as javelins. These were designed to be thrown into the enemy ranks before closing in with sword, axe, or club. Our team is soon throwing javelins with some skill. That's good, but look what happens to javelins against this Roman shield and armor.
Now, that's not so good. Most of our javelins bounced off the shields, and they certainly wouldn't penetrate armor. You'd be very lucky to hit an unprotected face or arm. What's more, the Romans advanced with much better spacing than this, so they presented less of a target for the javelins. Let's look at some other weapons. There's a couple of weapons we haven't talked about. One is cavalry, and the other is this, the bow. Now, John, you know a little about this. Here are some bows. Show them what to do.
The bow and arrow is a relatively lightweight and all-purpose weapon. Many barbarian tribes included bows as part of their arsenal. But in battle, they presented some of the same problems as the throwing axe. Shot straight on, many arrows would either miss their target or bounce away harmlessly. Instead, squads of barbarian archers would aim high in the air, creating a deadly rain and, in theory, terrifying the soldiers below. In close combat, barbarians used various types of cutting weapons.
This is the Gallic longsword. It's a slashing weapon, very blade heavy. You can use it either with two hands or with a single hand and a shield. And against a lightly armored opponent, this would be deadly, and it looks terrifying. But it will not penetrate a Roman shield. And if you get this stuck in that shield, even for a second, he'll be stabbing into your guts. Now, an alternative is this, the Dacian falx, with a forward curving blade that went right over the shield into the helmet of the Roman. In fact, later Roman helmets had reinforcing crossbars to prevent this weapon killing the man who's wearing it. But, again, you've got to hit him with your first stroke, because if you don't, he will. Now, the axe. Everyone thinks this is a great weapon until you actually have to use it. It's true, it's very heavy. And if you actually get a good hard hit on the shield or on the armor, you'll cleave right through it. But he's not going to let you do that. The moment you start your swing, he's going to tuck under that shield, push in and stab. Of course, you can get a shield yourself. But if you do that, well, you have to have a much lighter axe in the other hand, which has much less penetration. And even then, for every stroke you give him, he can get two stabs in. Now, here is a weapon that really might work. The falcata. Now, this had a really useful downward stroke and was so heavy and so sharp that it could pierce through shield, armor, and helmet. It also had a really useful point on it. And what's more, it was used with a left-hand buckler, small shield called a chytra. Now, this combination had a lot more power than the gladius, and it was much more maneuverable than that heavy shield. But I still don't like the odds.
To even things up, barbarians relied on a tried-and-true military tactic. If you can't beat them, join them.
Barbarians who fought in the Roman army as auxiliaries learnt about Roman weapons and tactics. One such person was Arminius, who led the Cherusci tribe of northern Germany. He knew he had to force the legion to fight on ground where they could not use their massed formations. And this is the ground he chose. In the year 9 AD, three Roman legions were led deep into the Teutoburger forest. In the thick woods and undergrowth, the Romans could not fight as a unit, and their heavy armor, shields, and weapons were of no use to them. The barbarians ambushed them repeatedly, day and night, jumping at them from every direction. Of 15,000 Romans, only 300 escaped. The Romans could ambush them repeatedly, day and night, jumping at them from every direction. Of 15,000 Romans, only 300 escaped. The Romans could be defeated.
If barbarians were to have continued success against the Romans, they would need to use every weapon they could get their barbaric hands on.
In the last centuries of the Roman Empire, the whole attitude became much more defensive as Rome withdrew behind walls and fortifications. And you can see this attitude in the weapons of the common soldier of the late Roman army. Look at this sword. It's not a gladius, it's a spatha, a longsword. The gladius was sharp, short, aggressive, a get-in-close weapon. The spatha's much longer. It says, get away from me, get back. The gladius is out. You can see it in the spear, too. The old Roman javelin, that's rejected. Now he carries a spear, purely defensive weapon. You don't want to throw it, you want to protect yourself with it. And look at his shield, much smaller now. The armor is now mail, not plate. The Roman soldier was less fit, less well-trained, less motivated than he was before. Look at this guy. He looks like a barbarian. That's because he is one. By the 3rd and 4th centuries, the vast majority of the army was made up of barbarians called into Roman service. You guys had got inside. The Romans weren't Roman anymore. They'd lost that aggressive spirit that kept them going. Now, at last, the Romans are just another army.
Our team of barbarians has a chance. Coming up, watch out, Romans. It's payback time. It's the final showdown for our team of barbarians as they face off against a Roman legion.
There is the enemy, the Roman invaders. Your chance for revenge at last. You've made your plan. Take up positions for attack.
The first wave is a frontal assault, easily repelled by the Romans. Our team members know that they must change tactics. Now the barbarians attack with spear and shield men in a wedge formation, as learned from the Romans. They don't try to fight with the Roman line, but to pierce it, to split it into two halves. Despite hard fighting from the Romans, their force is split up. Now each half can be attacked in a different way. The first half is bunched up by our barbarians, who run into the attack and then immediately withdraw.
Ready, draw!
Then Archers shoot at the gathered Romans. They are outflanked and shot down one by one, and those who try to break out are cut down. The second group of Romans is driven back into rough, wooded ground. Here the Roman formation breaks up, and their unique weapons are of no advantage. At last, individual barbarians fight individual Romans and beat them. The ferocity of the barbarian warrior is unleashed, and legions of Roman soldiers pay the ultimate price.
Team. On their side, the barbarians had vast numbers, many different weapons, and outstanding courage. But at first, they could not defeat the Roman military machine. It was only when Rome weakened and barbarian tactics improved that decisive victory was achieved. Just like our team, they had to learn how to win with barbarian weapons.